the Crowell School Business Investment Society is putting this on. The Crowell School Business Investment Society is actually having a meeting May 14th. If you guys would like to go, it's at night sometime. And we're actually having an end of the year barbecue, which is kind of wrapping it up for the year. We've been doing a couple events over the year, and this is kind of our peak event. And yeah, we'd love to have you guys come to any of the meetings or whatnot. So our speaker tonight is actually a Biola alumni. He has an MBA in finance from the Chicago Booth School of Business, and currently works for an accounting firm in the area. Professor Massey.
Thank you, JC, and good evening to all of you. I'm grateful to the Investment Society and to the Biola Republican Club for inviting me to speak on this topic tonight. I've had the privilege of working with JC and with Scott Gamelson and with Ali, where are you? Oh, she's uncomfortable. I've had the pleasure of working with them as the faculty advisor this year for the Biola Republican Club, and so I really appreciate all of the diligence and hard work that they've put into the events that they've planned this semester. Well, capitalism is one of those subjects about which it's easy to make jokes, and here's just one joke amongst many that I found online this week. A story about capitalism. So if the traditional view of capitalism is as follows, you have two cows, you sell one and buy a bull. Your herd multiplies and the economy grows. You sell them and retire on the income. So if that's traditional capitalism, now it goes through and compares all of the different variations across several nations. So here's American capitalism. You have two cows, you sell one and force the other to produce the milk of four cows. You are surprised when the cow drops dead. French capitalism. You have two cows, you go on strike because you want three cows. Japanese capitalism. You have two cows, you redesign them so they are one-tenth the size of an ordinary cow and produce 20 times the milk. You then create cow cartoon images called Kokemon and market them worldwide. German capitalism. You have two cows, you re-engineer them so they live for 100 years, eat once a month, and milk themselves. Italian capitalism. You have two cows, but you don't know where they are, so you break for lunch. And then finally, British capitalism, my favorite. You have two cows, both of them are mad. Well, we could go on with jokes about capitalism, but we do have a very important topic that we are going to be talking about tonight. Capitalism, is it biblical? The business headlines of the first decade of the 21st century have not been the best advertisement for capitalism. Here are just some of the headlines that we've seen. Enron declares bankruptcy after massive accounting fraud. WorldCom admits to an $11 billion revenue misstatement. Bernie Madoff makes off with $18 billion in investors' money. MF Global is unable to explain the disappearance of $1.2 billion in client holdings. Now, these headlines all cry out that something is badly broken. Capitalism, it would seem, has betrayed the trust of people time after time. Thus, we find ourselves asking, do these headlines mean that capitalism itself is the culprit? Is there something immoral about capitalism? And then more to the point, what should a Christian's perspective be toward capitalism? The title of tonight's event is Capitalism, Is It Biblical? But I think a better way to phrase the question is this. Should a Christian be a capitalist? Note that I say should, not can. Because as the Apostle Paul famously taught in 1 Corinthians 8, just because we as Christians can do something doesn't mean that we should do so. In Paul's case, he was explaining the issue of whether to eat meat sacrificed to idols. And he concluded 1 Corinthians 8 by saying this, "If food causes my brother to stumble, I will never eat meat again, so that I will not cause my brother to stumble." So you see, for Paul, the issue was not whether he could eat meat, which he clearly could. but whether he should eat meat. And that, I think, is the question that we must ask in tonight's discussion. We are not asking if Christians can be capitalists, but whether they should be capitalists. Jay Richards, author of a book called Money, Greed, and God, a book that I will be referring to quite often tonight, writes that the big question is this. Is the capitalist system consistent with Christian morality? If a free market economy contradicts Christian ethics, Christians can't be capitalists. Now, as we explore this question, I think we should start by recognizing one simple fact, which is that the Bible does not really seek to answer the question of economic theories for the simple reason that the two principal schools of economic thought, capitalism and socialism, did not exist at the time the Bible was written. Given this, how are we to try to explore this question? Because if we try to say that the Bible teaches either capitalism or socialism, what we would really be doing is imposing our own presuppositions on the text and trying to make it say something that it does not actually say. Therefore, the approach that I will use as we try to answer this question is to explore what are some of the important values that the Bible clearly does teach, and then try to show that capitalism does the best job of fulfilling those values. Now, this is not to say that capitalism is perfect. No economic system is without its faults. After all, we are sinners, and we live in a fallen, sinful world. However, my thesis is that capitalism comes closest to living up to some important truths and values that the Bible clearly does teach. So therefore, let us explore now what these biblical values are. The first biblical value: which economic system does the best job of treating all people as having equal human worth without showing partiality? We might refer to this as the Declaration of Independence question. Which economic system does the best job of living up to the proposition that all men are created equal? Secondly, which system does the best job of respecting free will? Thirdly, which system best promotes responsible stewardship of wealth? And finally, which system does the best job of promoting a proper sense of social responsibility to the poor? I will attempt to show that capitalism does the best job of promoting these four biblical values. Before we begin to answer these questions, however, I should give a few stipulations to my thesis. The first stipulation: capitalism does not equal an unbridled pursuit of wealth for wealth's sake. That is to say, the intent of capitalism is, in the truest sense, is not for someone to accumulate vast sums of money and then hoard that wealth like some modern-day Ebenezer Scrooge. Rather, true capitalism is a vehicle for producing goods and services. The entrepreneur who succeeds in an initial venture then seeks to reinvest the fruit of his or her labor in additional endeavors. My second stipulation: capitalism needs the rule of law, for capitalism without moral restraint and the rule of law is anarchy. I think the headlines that I listed at the beginning of this discussion should provide ample evidence of that fact. In each of those cases that I mentioned, one or more individuals acted without regard for what was morally right and became a law unto themselves. Moral restraint and the rule of law, and specifically moral restraint that is based on what we would call the Protestant work ethic or the Judeo-Christian value system, is an indispensable foundation for capitalism's long-term survival. Capitalism simply will not survive if either one of those foundations is weakened or removed, or if it is built on the wrong value system. My third stipulation: abuses of capitalism by individuals are not necessarily an indictment of capitalism itself. For instance, when Eve ate the forbidden fruit, we would not say that her sin of eating the forbidden fruit was somehow an indictment of the fruit itself or of the Garden of Eden. Similarly, The fact that humans figured out how to extract juice from grapes, ferment it to make wine, and then drink wine to excess is not an indictment of the grape. In both of these cases, the individuals are responsible for the moral choices that they made. The same is true for capitalism. When we see scandals like Enron, Bernie Madoff, and Emmett Goebel, we should not be too hasty to say that capitalism itself is to blame. Instead, we should seek to hold the individuals responsible for abusing a system and making wrong moral choices. So with these stipulations in mind, let us now proceed to explore these four biblical values. Our first biblical value, which system does the best job of treating all people as having equal human worth? Now, why is this question important? We know from scripture that God hates favoritism and partiality, and I've listed just a few of the verses that demonstrate that. James 2:1, my brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Acts 10:34, truly I understand that God shows no partiality. Romans 2:11, there is no respect of persons with God. Deuteronomy 1:17, you shall not be partial in judgment. Therefore, we must judge economic systems based on their track record of treating all people as having equal human worth without showing partiality. To have any hope of creating a system that treats all people as having equal human worth, a society must have a strong rule of law, and this rule of law must be one to which even the powerful are subject. Therefore, we naturally ask which societies have generally done the best job of having a strong rule of law that treats people as having equal human worth. And historically, we see that the Western democracies that operate under varying degrees of capitalism have shown the most resilience in this regard. In England, for instance, the Magna Carta established the principle that even the king is subject to the law. This gave rise to a Latin maxim called lex rex, the law is king. This was in contrast to older notions of kings as having a divine right by which they can do whatever they please. In our own nation, we are well acquainted with the stirring words of the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. Now, though our nation has had to travel a journey of nearly two centuries before that proposition could be said to have been fully realized, the principle of the equality of all men has been present since our nation's founding. We must then ask how capitalism is consistent with the rule of law. A capitalist economic system is built on such principles as recognizing legal title to property, recognizing intellectual property through patents and copyrights, upholding labor laws, financial regulations, and workplace safety regulations, and so on. And we can especially see that many of these provisions, such as labor laws and workplace safety regulations, implicitly recognize the equal human worth of all humans. They place a premium on the value of human life and treat individuals as possessing human capital that needs to be protected instead of treating individuals as slave labor to be exploited. By contrast, we know from history that the most extreme forms of socialist regimes, namely the communist regimes, have done a very poor record of treating people as having equal human worth. The brutal human rights abuses of the former Soviet Union, communist China, and Cambodia under the Khmer Rouge are well documented. Now, although the Soviet Union and communist China hold the record for absolute numbers of people that were killed under their regimes, Khmer Rouge Cambodia holds the record for the greatest proportional killing of its citizens. According to Jay Richards, in less than 4 years, the Khmer Rouge killed more than 25% of the population of Cambodia. So in these socialist regimes, all people have most certainly not been treated as having equal human worth. There has been a stark difference between the elite ruling class and the rest of the population. Now, we may be inclined to say that the communist regimes failed because they were anti-democratic and totalitarian. So how about the more moderate socialist nations, the social democracies of Europe? Since these countries also have rule of law that strive to treat people as having equal worth under the law, should they be examples for us to emulate? Not necessarily. As the events of the past 2 years have demonstrated, these nations are struggling mightily with being able to keep their financial house in order. Greece and Portugal, for instance, have required bailouts, and we have not yet seen the end of this crisis. Now, a significant cause of Europe's financial disarray, I believe, lies in a welfare state that is far more protectionist than the United States toward the native members of its population, and it's in the form of economically unsustainable welfare benefits. At the same time, these protectionist policies end up treating even legal immigrants as second-class citizens who are stuck in a permanent underclass. As far back as 2005, Business Week magazine was reporting on some of the significant social problems in countries like France, and here's what Business Week said. For decades, government policies across much of the old world have put a higher value on social protections and job security than on growth and job creation. Those policies had the laudable goal of guaranteeing everyone a decent standard of living. But instead, in today's globalized economy, they are helping to create a vast underclass of jobless youths, many from immigrant backgrounds. For at least 5 years, economic growth across most of the continent has been far too feeble to create jobs that could lift have-nots into the mainstream. France's economy has grown an average 1.5% annually for the past 4 years and is set to grow only 1.2% this year. Unemployment is nearly 10%, and among those under 25, it is nearly 22%, about twice the US rate. Youth joblessness runs over 50% in the suburbs that are home to many of France's more than 5 million first and second generation African and Arab immigrants. High unemployment among immigrants and young people isn't limited to France. Joblessness in Germany's Turkish immigrant community is an estimated 25%, and 14% of British Muslims are unemployed. Youth unemployment tops 20% in Italy, Spain, and Belgium. Mix in racial discrimination, crumbling education systems, and scant representation of ethnic minorities among the political and business elite, and it's easy to see why young immigrants are alienated. More than anything, it's the welfare state that stifles job creation. European governments tax businesses heavily to pay for welfare, unemployment, and health benefits. Such taxes, including contributions by workers, account for 16.4% of France's economy and 14.4% of Germany's, versus only 6.7% in the US. On top of that, governments saddle companies with rigid labor rules that make it difficult to lay off workers or hire them on temporary contracts. Business Week's critique of the high tax rates used to subsidize the European welfare state belies what I believe to be Europe's fundamentally misplaced notion of equality. In this first biblical value, I have been talking about all people as possessing equal human worth, but not equal economic worth. The first is indispensable, but not the latter. All people must possess equal human worth, but there is no requirement that they must all possess equal economic worth. To illustrate this in simple and practical terms, a child has as much human worth as his or her parents do, but obviously lacks equal economic worth. Likewise, you as college graduates starting your first job will not possess anything remotely close to the economic worth of someone who has spent 30 or 40 years working in a career. you will only have the same level of human worth as a senior career employee. So this misunderstanding about economic worth, I believe, is what lies behind one of the most common complaints we hear about capitalism, which is the issue of growing income inequality. We are constantly being told that there is a growing gap between the rich and the poor, and that, like the social democracies of Europe, we must level the playing field by taking from the rich. However, I believe the key question to ask is not whether there is a growing gap between the rich and the poor. Instead, the question we should be asking is twofold. First of all, are those at the bottom, by their own standards, comparatively better off than they were at some earlier point in time? And secondly, are those at the top increasing in wealth in a manner that does not come at the expense of those at the bottom? If the answer to both of these questions is yes, then growing income inequality is not a moral tragedy. If those at the bottom of the income scale are better off than they were at some earlier point in time, then it does not matter if their rate of growth has lagged behind those at the top. There is no requirement that everyone must grow at the same rate. Some may grow faster than others do, but as long as everyone is growing, we can still say that a society is treating its members justly. One reason that some people say that wealth inequality is unjust is that they make the fallacy of assuming that wealth is a zero-sum game. That is to say, they assume that if one person grows richer, it necessarily means that someone else has grown poorer. In other words, there's only a finite pie of total wealth, and if someone gets a bigger slice of that pie, it means that someone else is getting a smaller slice. Now, if this were in fact the case, then growing income inequality would in fact be a moral tragedy, for the answer to both of these questions would be no. That is, those at the bottom would be growing worse off, and it would be at their expense that those at the top are becoming richer. In such a case, there would be a moral injustice, a type of inequality that the Bible clearly does condemn in passages such as these. James 2:6. Are not the rich the ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Matthew 23:14. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses. So in these passages, the rich are clearly exploiting the poor, and without question, that is unjust. However, in a capitalist society, wealth is not a zero-sum game. Over time, the entire pie actually grows larger so that it is entirely possible for both those at the top and those at the bottom to increase in wealth and have more than they did before. That is to say that living standards rise across all income levels. Now, there's a huge difference between what we would call absolute poverty, which means not having a place to live or lacking food and clothing, versus relative poverty, which means just not having as much stuff as those who are more affluent do. For the most part, poverty in America is defined as relative poverty, not absolute poverty. Therefore, in these cases, if growing income inequality is due to honest differences in the level of industry that someone has exerted without exploiting others, then we should not be troubled by these types of inequality. A glimpse of this is in Jesus' parable of the talents. Now, I concede at the outset that the point of that parable is about stewardship, not income inequality. Nevertheless, we do see an aspect of income inequality in the parable. So at the beginning of the story, the first steward has been entrusted with 5 talents, and the second steward has been entrusted with 2 talents. This is a difference in wealth of 3 talents. And since 1 talent was equal to 20 years' wages, this means that there was an income gap of 60 years' wages. Now, at the end of the story, after these 2 stewards have doubled their stewardship to 10 and 4 talents, now there is an income gap of 6 talents, which equates to 120 years' wages. Yet what Jesus condemns is not this inequality. What he condemns is the laziness of the third steward, who took his talent and went and buried it in the ground. So we conclude then that equal human worth is what matters most. Therefore, which economic system does the best job of treating all people as having equal human worth without showing partiality? I believe the historical evidence shows that capitalism does the best job in this regard. Our second question, which system does the best job of respecting free will? Free will is obviously an important component of the way that God created us as individuals. In the words of pastor and theologian John Piper, God must give man a free will and allow man to reject God's plan to save him. The reason is that only a free being with an independent will can love. If love was to be a meaningful thing, Adam had to be allowed some free choice. God does not want mule-like servants who have to be forced to obey him all the time. He wants those who will freely accept his instruction and counsel. He wants relationships of mutual affection and love, not those based on some kind of force. God could bridle unbelievers, tinker with their wills and hearts, and turn them into automata or mules, so that they have to do what he says. But if he did this, it would still not achieve his purpose of developing free relationships. When we compare capitalism and socialism, we see very clearly that capitalism depends on the ability of market participants to make free choices, where socialism depends heavily on a strong element of coercion. One of the common criticisms of capitalism is that it promotes greed. In the movie Wall Street, the character Gordon Gekko famously says, "Greed is good." Now, many critics of capitalism point to such sentiments as one of capitalism's major flaws, but they are mistaken. Capitalism does not make people greedy. Rather, greed is a condition of the human heart. That is to say, we are fallen, sinful beings, and one of our sins is a propensity toward greed. Greed exists even in socialist societies. In fact, in some ways, it is even worse. The reason is that, as Jay Richards says, high rates of taxation in socialist societies leave people feeling resentful, as though they have already, quote, given at the office, and therefore it causes them to want to hold on to what they have left. Capitalism is the best economic system for dealing with fallen, sinful human beings because it can actually channel greed into socially constructive behavior. Turning yet again to Jay Richards' book, he draws a lesson from Adam Smith's concept of the invisible hand of the market by citing the example of a greedy, corrupt meat butcher, and this is what he says. Even if the butcher is selfish, even if the butcher would love nothing more than to sell you a spoiled chunk of grisly beef in exchange for your worldly goods and leave you homeless, the butcher can't make you buy his meat in a free economy. He has to offer you meat you freely buy. The cruel, greedy butcher, in other words, has to look for ways to set up win-win scenarios. Even to satisfy his greed, he has to meet your desires. The market makes this happen. Richards then goes on to explain that entrepreneurship in a capitalist economy actually fosters virtuous behavior. This is what he says. Right off the bat, if I'm an entrepreneur, I have to think about the wants and needs of others. I must make or acquire something desirable. Great entrepreneurs succeed by anticipating and meeting the desires of others. Competition between entrepreneurs in a free economy thus becomes an altruistic competition, not because the entrepreneurs have warm fuzzies in their hearts or are unconcerned with personal wealth, but because they seek to meet the desires of others better than their competitors do. At the base of the capitalist system is not greed or consumption, but intuition, imagination, and creation. As Thomas Edison said, I find out what the world needs, then I proceed to invent it. Now, in this regard, the entrepreneur actually acts consistent with the command of Philippians 2:4 to look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Now, although the point of that passage is for us as Christians to imitate the humble love of Christ, it still has a useful principle that is relevant to capitalism. In a capitalist society, the only way an entrepreneur can succeed is by taking time to find out what the interests of others are, and then creating goods or services that will meet those needs and that others will really buy. Now, notice the important wording of the verse in Philippians. It says, we should look not only to our own interests. It does not say that they should not look to their own interests at all, which would entail acting out of complete altruism. As the ESV Study Bible notes, Paul realizes that everyone naturally looks out for his or her own interests. The key is to take that same level of concern and apply it also to the interests of others. So this describes an entrepreneur quite well. An entrepreneur is naturally looking out for his or her own interests, but is doing so by seeking out the interests of others in order to meet them. By contrast, socialism violates the principle of free will and instead relies on coercion. We are seeing a very real example of this in the current debate over Obamacare. Now, I want to be very careful and state that I'm not saying that Obamacare equals socialism. However, the elements of coercion that often typify socialism are very present in Obamacare, both from the standpoint of the consumer and from the standpoint of the producer. So from the standpoint of the consumer, we see that the individual mandate forces an individual to purchase a product that he or she may not want to buy. Going back to Adam Smith's example of the meat butcher, the consumer is required under penalty of paying a fine to buy a piece of meat, the meat in this case being health insurance, which the consumer may find undesirable. From the standpoint of the producer, we see coercion in the controversy over the contraception mandate and its unprecedented assault on religious liberty. By mandating that all insurance plans must offer contraception, Obamacare violates the freedom of insurance companies to tailor their insurance policies to meet the needs of their customers, and it forces religious institutions to purchase a product that they find morally objectionable. Now, some have tried to defend the contraception mandate by noting that many practicing Catholics do in fact use contraception in spite of the church's teaching on the subject. But this completely misses the point. The point is that before the contraception mandate, the Catholic Church was not obligated to provide contraception to its individual members. Any individual member who chose to use contraception did so of her own free will and out of her own resources, not the resources of the Catholic Church. Now, however, the government is using its power to dictate to the Catholic Church which of its teachings it considers valid, and since the government does not consider the Church's position on contraception to be valid, it is crushing the church's religious liberty and free will by mandating that it provide contraception through its insurance policies. In an essay for Summit Ministries, author Ronald Nash quotes the economist Walter Williams as stating, there are two, and only two ways in which something may be exchanged, the peaceful means of exchange and the violent means of exchange. The peaceful means of exchange may be summed up in the phrase, if you do something good for me, then I'll do something good for you. When capitalism is understood correctly, it epitomizes the peaceful means of exchange. But exchange can also take place by means of force and violence. In this violent means of exchange, the basic rule of thumb is, unless you do something good for me, I'll do something bad. This turns out to be the controlling principle of socialism. So note that statement, unless you do something good for me, I'll do something bad to you. This is exactly what we are seeing with Obamacare. To the consumer, Obamacare says, unless you buy an insurance policy, you will pay a fine. And to the producer, Obamacare says, you must offer contraceptive coverage free of charge, even if it violates your moral standards. Thus, Obamacare is doing great violence to free will on both sides of its framework. Therefore, which economic system does the best job of respecting free will? From the examples that we have studied, I believe that capitalism respects free will the most. Our third question, which system best promotes responsible stewardship of wealth? We should first define what responsible stewardship of wealth means. In broadest terms, it means that those who possess wealth use it in ways that are productive rather than destructive. One of the sins that the Bible clearly condemns is the sin of hoarding wealth. So, for example, in the parable of the rich fool in Luke 12, Jesus condemns the rich fool for wanting to build bigger barns in order to store his harvest and hoard it for himself. In Haggai 1, the Lord condemns the Israelites for hoarding their wealth in order to build fancy houses while neglecting to give to rebuilding the house of the Lord. And then in Joshua 7, the Lord punishes Israel for Achan's sin of taking the forbidden plunder of Jericho in order to hoard it for himself. So the unmistakable lesson from these passages is that God expects those whom he has blessed with wealth to use that wealth productively. Therefore, we should ask, does capitalism promote a productive or destructive use of wealth? Returning to Jay Richards' book, he writes, "The grasping or hoarding rich man is the antithesis of capitalism, not its epitome," writes George Gilder, "more a feudal figure than a bourgeois one. The miser prefers the certainty and security of his booty. It's right there in his cold hands. Entrepreneurs, in contrast, assume risk. They cast their bread upon the waters of uncertainty, hoping that the bread will return with fish. They delay whatever gratification their wealth might provide now for the hope of future gain. The miser treats his bullion as an end in itself. The entrepreneur, whatever his motives, including the desire for more money, uses money as a tool. The carpenter uses hammer and saw. The doctor, scalpel and stethoscope. The entrepreneur, cash and credit." Richards then goes on to show that the entrepreneur practices a whole host of virtues, including delaying gratification by investing rather than consuming wealth, providing stability for those employed by their neighbors, having faith in their society and employees, anticipating the needs of others, and then making disciplined choices. By contrast, socialism, almost by its very nature, involves the hoarding or concentration of wealth in the hands of a very few people. When the government controls and plans an economy, the government accumulates vast amounts of wealth in that economy. This concentration of wealth, I believe, is what leads to, at best, crony capitalism, where the government dispenses special favors to politically favored constituencies, and at best, outright bribery and corruption of government officials. These are destructive rather than productive uses of wealth. Now, the United States is not without blemish when it comes to crony capitalism under both political parties. As the federal government has grown increasingly large and powerful, we have seen the government give special dispensations to politically favored constituencies, such as the Wall Street bailouts in the closing days of the George W. Bush administration, or loans to Solyndra under the current administration. Now, these examples of crony capitalism are what have led to protest on the part of ordinary Americans who feel that the government should stop bailing out these powerful companies and return to a more traditional form of a capitalist economy with smaller, limited government. In a limited government capitalist system, crony capitalism and or bribery of government officials become far less likely if those who are in government lack the economic power to dispense special favors in the first place. So therefore, which system does the best job of promoting responsible stewardship of wealth? I believe that capitalism does this the best. And now our fourth question. Which system does the best job of promoting a proper sense of social responsibility to the poor? This is the last and possibly most important biblical value for judging an economic system. God's heart for the poor is one of the most powerful themes that we read throughout the Bible. If you search the website BibleGateway.com for the word poor, you will receive approximately 8 pages of results. Here is just a brief sampling of verses showing God's tender heart for the weak and vulnerable. Exodus 23:6. You shall not pervert the justice due to your poor in his lawsuit. Deuteronomy 15:7. You shall not harden your heart or shut your hand against your poor brother. 1 Samuel 2:8. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap. Psalm 72:12. For he delivers the needy when he calls, the poor and him who has no helper. Psalm 68:5. Father of the fatherless and protector of the widows is God in his holy habitation. James 1:27. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their affliction. Clearly then, God expects us to take care of the poor, the weak, and the vulnerable. The crucial divide between those from a capitalist perspective and those from a socialist perspective is this: whose responsibility is it to provide for the needy? Typically, at least here in America, conservatives argue for private philanthropy to help the poor, whereas liberals argue for government programs to do so. Now, as I read the scriptures, I believe a compelling case can be made that God always places the responsibility for helping the poor on his people as individuals. He wants them personally to help the poor, not rely on a government agency to do it for them. We see this in passages such as the following. Leviticus 19:10. And you shall not strip your vineyard bare, neither shall you gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and for the sojourner. Leviticus 23:22. And when you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap your field right up to its edge, nor shall you gather the gleanings after your harvest. You shall leave them for the poor and for the sojourner. Deuteronomy 26:12. When you have finished paying all the tithe of your produce in the third year, which is the year of tithing, giving it to the Levite, the sojourner, the fatherless, and the widow, so that they may eat within your towns and be filled. Matthew 25:35-37. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Mark 10:21. And Jesus said to him, you lack one thing. Go, sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Acts 4:34-35. There was not a needy person among them. For as many as were owners of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold and laid it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to each as any had need. James 2:15-16. If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? 1 John 3:17. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? I could probably find another dozen passages like these, but these should suffice to make the point. In the two Leviticus passages, God commands his people that they should leave a portion of their fields unharvested so that the poor and sojourner may freely eat of the fruit of the land. In Deuteronomy, God commands the Israelites to use their tithe to care for the sojourner, the fatherless, and the widow. In Mark, Jesus commands the rich man to give to the poor out of his own wealth. In Acts, we see that the early Christians did exactly that. They met the needs of the poor themselves out of their own wealth. As a side note, this is why this passage in Acts cannot be used as a proof text for socialism. These early Christians were practicing individual voluntary philanthropy, not forced government redistribution of wealth. Now the passages in Matthew, James, and 1 John go on to show what such individual philanthropy looks like for the Christian. So God expects his own people to share of their own wealth in meeting the needs of the poor. He simply has not given us the option of abdicating that responsibility to a government welfare agency that redistributes wealth in order to help the poor. In fact, Christian charity is actually far more virtuous than government welfare. Government welfare is bureaucratic and inefficient and typically treats the recipients of aid as case numbers. Christian charity preserves the human dignity of those to whom it acts as the hands and feet of Christ. This is perhaps one of the most misunderstood aspects of capitalism. Capitalism is actually a superior system for meeting the needs of the poor because it promotes the ability to care for the poor in the way that God has prescribed, individual responsibility, not governmental responsibility. In a landmark book on philanthropy called Who Really Cares? The Surprising Truth About Compassionate Conservatism, social scientist Arthur C. Brooks documents the stark differences between philanthropy in the United States versus the social democracies of Europe. One of the prime examples he cites is the response of Western nations in providing aid to Indonesia and the other nations that were affected by the catastrophic earthquake and tsunami of 2004. This is what Professor Brooks writes. By the middle of March 2005, the World Food Program, sponsored by the United Nations, had distributed more than $250 million, or $250 million, in aid to disaster victims. This much or more had been pledged as well by the governments of many developed countries, including Germany, $674 million, Australia, $380 million, Japan, $500 million, and the United States, $350 million. And now here's his key point. In the United States, the majority of aid came from private citizens. Individual contributions outstripped the government aid by almost 3-1. 6 months after the disaster, Americans had donated more than $1.5 billion in cash and gifts. America was nevertheless criticized for the inadequacy of its aid efforts. Many critics of the Bush administration noted that the most generous of governments, Germany, pledged nearly twice as much in assistance as the US government. Why do Europeans persist in their criticisms of American generosity? One reason is that giving at the private level is a foreign concept to them. There is so little private charity in Europe that it is difficult to find information on the subject. So irrelevant is it that few researchers have even bothered to investigate it recently. So notice a key statement here. The United States government was criticized for pledging only $350 million in aid, whereas the German government had pledged $674 million. Now, lost in the criticism is the fact that the American people, as individuals, gave through private philanthropy nearly 2.5 times the amount of the German government and thrice the amount of the Japanese government. Which is more impressive? The fact that the national governments of the world's third and fourth largest economies, with all of their taxing power, gave $1.2 billion in aid, or the fact that ordinary Americans
significance, out of their own resources, gave more than both of those nations' governments combined. Notice also Mr. Brooks' statement that there is very little private charity in Europe. To show this, the Johns Hopkins University Center for Civil Society Studies has compiled data on charitable giving as a percentage of GDP for over 30 countries. And now here is its comparison of the United States to several major Western European nations, showing how much private philanthropic giving was as a percentage of that nation's GDP. And using that percentage, I have combined it with the International Monetary Fund's 2011 data of each nation's GDP in order to show what the total charitable giving is in millions of US dollars. So what do we see here? We see that the United States is at the top of the list where charitable giving is 1.85% of GDP. Amongst the major Western European nations, Spain is at the top of the list at less than half the level of the United States at 0.87%. And then look where Germany is. It's almost at the very bottom at 0.13%. Now, let's look at these numbers in a slightly different way. Germany is Europe's largest economy as measured by GDP, with a GDP of just under $3.6 trillion. The United States is approximately a little more than four times that amount at $15 trillion. But now look at the comparison of giving in Germany versus giving in the United States. In Germany, charitable giving is $4.6 billion. And in the United States, it is 60 times that amount at $279 billion. So the United States, the economy is only about four times as large as that of Germany, but the charitable giving is 60 times as large. So why is it that in the passage I cited from Arthur C. Brooks, Germany was praised as a generous donor to tsunami relief, while the United States was criticized as stingy? This is the untold story of capitalism. Free people, raised in a culture where private philanthropy is promoted, are far more immensely generous than their counterparts in a European social democracy party. Therefore, if we accept the proposition that God calls his people to care for the poor themselves out of their own will and not hand it off to a government agency to do it for them, then we return to the question of which system does the best job of promoting a sense of social responsibility to the poor. Based on the data that we have presented contrasting philanthropy in the United States versus Europe, we must conclude that capitalism does the best job of promoting social responsibility to the poor. So we began our discussion this evening by asking the question, should Christians be capitalists? We set out to answer this question by exploring four biblical values that are useful for judging an economic system. And then we explored each of those values in depth and saw that on each one, capitalism does the best job of fulfilling those values. Winston Churchill, in commenting on democracy, once quipped, "Democracy is the worst form of government, except for all of those other forms that have been tried from time to time." Perhaps we could say something similar about capitalism. Capitalism is the worst system of economics, except for all those other systems that have been tried from time to time. As we said at the outset, capitalism is not perfect, but neither is any other economic system. Those who would assail capitalism and charge it with various sins must do two things. First of all, they must show that such a sin is not a sin of fallen human nature that would exist under any economic system, but is instead uniquely an actual sin of capitalism itself. Secondly, they must demonstrate that some other economic system has a proven track record in practice, not just in theory, of doing a superior job than capitalism on issues of biblical importance. If then, as we have demonstrated tonight, capitalism does the best job of promoting the biblical values that we have discussed, then we are left to answer the question, should Christians be capitalists? And in my opinion, I believe the unmistakable answer to that question is yes. Thank you for your time.
We'd now like to open up the questions for Professor Massey, and then we'll close.
Yes, please.
Where can we get a copy of this?
Of my lecture? I have it as a PDF. I can email it to JC. He can make it available to the Biola Republican Club, and I can email it to you as well. Thank you.
Yeah, and we're also filming this, so I believe it will be posted.
Thank you for coming. What influenced you to talk on this topic?
The Biola Republicans actually invited me to speak on this topic. One of the things that I appreciate about JC so much is that he's been someone who really is interested in getting us as Christians to think about how politics affects our faith. And so JC and I have been discussing this topic back in the fall semester. And I had expressed to him my interest in possibly being able to speak on this topic, given my background in business and finance. And so JC and I and Bob Gamson as well, and the other leaders of the Investment Society, put together this evening, and I spent some time over the past couple of weeks researching this topic. Yes, Jordan.
This might be a question. What do you think is the greatest argument?
Well, obviously, some of the arguments against what I talked about are the things that I mentioned. For instance, the growing inequality of wealth is one of the things that people cite. The assertion that capitalism promotes greed is one of the other arguments that people cite. And so I think those are probably the two biggest criticisms that people usually have against capitalism. But then, as I mentioned, you need to understand those arguments in their proper context and evaluate them properly to understand that those are truly valid criticisms against capitalism. Yes, please.
Would you care to give us an idea of your concept of what the Occupy Wall Street was all about?
It's funny you should ask that, because I was just watching a news video today. Some of you might have seen this if you watch Fox News, or Sean Hannity interviewing an Occupy Wall Street organizer. And basically, this 29-year-old Occupy Wall Street organizer was saying that in his view, government and society basically owes him everything. It should provide education for free, it should provide housing for free, it should provide health insurance for free, it should provide basic living necessities for free, it should provide transportation for free. And so Sean Hannity asked him, who pays for all of this? And this Occupy Wall Street guy said, nobody, it's free. I said to myself, does he think that you just have some magic lamp that you rub and poof, all these things suddenly appear out of nowhere? I mean, somebody is paying to produce all of these goods and services. So that's one of the things that I've seen about the Occupy Wall Street movement. Okay. Well, again, thank you for coming out this evening, and I'll let JC close.
Yeah, well, we just close the prayer and let you go. Heavenly Father, thank you that we could all come here and, you know, talk about a topic like this, an amazing mentor we have. Thank you for Professor Massey and all the students that showed up today to learn about this subject. Please allow everyone to remember what they've heard tonight and take this message out to other people and spread the word of what Professor Massey has taught us tonight. And amen. You guys ready to go?